Good day. So this is the second of my talks on ideology and language teaching in Sri Lanka. The first four talks in English, you know, these talks are very much connected to each other. I'm making it very short because it's easier to listen to short talks than long ones. So I started the first program by talking about language and power and why it is important that we remember the power dynamics at work when we teach English. And I also said, I ended by saying, you know, we should be very careful when we laugh or when we look down on people who use what you might call a substandard language or substandard use of English, and that laughing at them or laughing at the kind of accent they use is really, not only is it not fair, but it's very not fair, it's also very harmful to students who will not go through the process of learning the language. Because this is what I'm trying to tell you today, learning a language is very much about use. You can, and this is in fact done, you give them 1,000 rules, you could give them notes, and they can, you know, in fact score 100 out of 100 for a grammar paper and still not use it, and still not be able to write a full sentence in a blank sheet. You can have an excellently erudite grammarian who will not be fluent in the language if he or she doesn't use it. So that is why it's imperative that as Sri Lankans, as a society, we get or we give a chance for language learners to use what you might call wrong English in the process of learning. And if we keep laughing or if we keep shutting them out and if we keep ridiculing them, it's not going to help and it's not going to improve the situation at all. So today I will deal with how we can make it easy for the adult language learner to get English close to them. Because if you, as I said in the first lesson, if a child grows up in an English-speaking environment, he or she would just absorb it without knowing she's learning a language, just like the baby learned her native tongue. But when you're an adult, the ego comes into play very much, and you know, you're ashamed of some things, you do not want to be laughed at, your ego. Ego and education is a very bad combination, and you know, it happens, all of us have egos. So I told that language learning is like learning swimming. You could give all the instructions about how to swim, you know, how to lift your hand, how to, you know, make your body function, or like say play the violin. I can tell you that the wrist has to be, so you can give the rules, but unless you actually hold the violin and you play it, people are not going to learn. You can't be a violinist without actually holding onto the violin, right? So language is very much like that, and today I'll discuss ways in which you can get this instrument or get the water around you in contexts where you're not naturally exposed to this language. And one thing I tell my students, you know, you can do it if schools also, anywhere at nursery level, expose the little children, say, you know, 4 or 5 year olds, you can even do it at home, even if you're not yourself an English language speaker, by turning the TV onto English channels. One of the things I think that we do, which is a pity, is to dub the cartoons that we export from outside into Sinhala or Tamil. It's much better to have those in English, and if you wish, have the subtitle go in whatever the native language is, and make the kids listen to the English language when they are very small, because they will absorb without knowing they're actually absorbing a new language, and like a powerful language. Only adults know that, right? And if you can get them to sing and dance, tell nursery rhymes. Even if you can't speak the language, there's YouTube if you have the internet, and that's also not, you know, commonly available everywhere. But if you can have access, even on a phone, to tap a nursery rhyme, tap cartoons, and show them that, kids, and especially cartoon films like say Kung Fu Panda or Coco or whatever, the children will be able to follow the storyline anyway by those pictures. It's not difficult. And without knowing, they'll be, you know, they'll be in the water. absorbing a few words so that when they come, like say to campus as young adults, this language is not, you know, it won't shock you. And in fact, I have seen that happen in my career as a teacher. So my advice is that if you are in a position to speak to people who are trying to teach English in rural areas, talk to the parents, tell them, put the channel into English. It doesn't matter if you don't understand. It doesn't matter if the child doesn't understand. He will at least be hearing this language. Put the songs, English songs, get them to dance to it. You know, if you're a young adult, I used to tell them, find a girlfriend or boyfriend and dance with, you know, to the English song. Look at English films. It's pretty fun. I used to, when I was a kid, I used to have a lesson, like once a month, where the class comes and watches a film. And I used to pick these, you know, children's cartoon films like Kung Fu Panda and Rio and all that. And they used to say, like, what's wrong with this head? Because, like, are we children? But, you know, I found it, I completely loved it. And, you know, it doesn't have much politics in it. And I could hear, we had darkened a particular room and put a huge screen there. I could hear people roar with laughter. And, you know, it was just utter fun. The whole class, we had 2-hour classes. The whole class was just watching the film for those 2 hours. And there was so much laughter. You might not know you're learning, and that's the best kind of learning. Because one of the biggest mistakes I think we have made in the education system is to take the element of fun out of learning. And especially for something like English, this is easily done. You know, you can make it fun. You can. You might feel guilty thinking, oh my God, learning is, you know, putting down rules, memorizing words. Yes, please do memorize if you can. But it doesn't necessarily have to be that difficult process. And if you're an adult, one superb thing you can do is actually read. Now, when I say read, I don't think that books, English books, are easily accessible to everyone. Any kind of book, if you don't have the economic strength to go and buy it. But I do know that there's a library system all over this country. There are villages with library, or well, they should be. And you could tell the librarian, please get us some easy readers or English books. Turn the page. If you're in the campus hostel, look at the English newspaper that comes every day. Right? Because the first day you might understand 2 words out of 100. But if you keep doing it every day, you know that number is going to go up. Guess when you're reading, if you're reading the headline, it's very easy to guess because you know what's going on. Unless you're reading during elections and 2 different papers say the same thing in 2 different ways. I mean, that of course happens. But you can guess it. And guessing is so much a part of reading an unfamiliar language, because even I guess, as an English teacher, I do not know all the words in English. But when you see a word in a particular context, your guess is more or less correct. Your guess doesn't have to be 100% that meaning. But if you can reach some kind of, this word has to be this, something like this, that's enough, because the meaning has come. Because language, remember, you determine success by what you understand. Language is communication, right? Language being communication is the reason that I tell you, don't laugh when someone gets it wrong. I have heard so many Americans in America use language which you might find grammatically incorrect, but it doesn't bother them. Because once the message gets through, that language has done what it was meant to do. So in Sri Lanka, I find it very disturbing that we penalize people for getting, you know, especially this S, present simple S kind of thing wrong. Because, yes, I mean, if you're a language teacher or if you're writing books in English, go ahead, please learn the right language. And even my students, I say, you know, use wrong English only in the process of going towards proficiency. Some people might never reach the end, but it's all right. They can function in English, and one of the reasons they don't is that they get ridiculed, right? So another way, like for example, now I said read and I said watch films, listen to songs. Another thing that you can listen when you're in, you know, at the moment maybe stuck way out of university system or education, you could watch the news. Because news, if you watch or hear, it goes once every hour in all our channels, you hear news in English and then maybe news in Sinhala, then you know what the English speaker is saying. Do not fear knowing little. Because if you fear going into this language when you know little, then you'll never get anywhere. But if you go into the process of learning, even by knowing a little, you're going to move forward. So one of the unfair things which happen in our country is that, I know ELTUs are judged very harshly, but because our examination or testing system is, we put one level or one standard for everybody, so that someone who's fluent in English has to just go one inch forward to become what you call a past student. But someone who had no exposure to English also has to reach that standard, you know, that examination standard. That is simply not fair, nor is it, you know, it is so unfair. It's surprising that more people are not fussing about it. We judge everybody's English standards when they speak, when they function in it, when they write, on one particular standard. When it is blatantly clear that no one is starting at the same point. So all this, whether we you can take it as, you know, I'm actually encouraging people to speak wrong English. I hope you don't take it like that. All I'm saying is, if somebody is making mistakes, remember they are on a journey, and then understand it and try not to put value judgments, especially ridicule, on young people or any age people, because it's within a system of injustice that they're learning. Right? And understand it. And if you're a teacher, remember these ways of getting the water to your students through newspapers if they're in a hostel, through books if they have a library which they can use, right? Through English films on TV, English cartoons like Sesame Street. Of course, there's ideology coming in. Again, that's a different subject. Just get them used to it. If you have children, put on your phone, or if you have internet, or just get them to dance with English songs and nursery rhymes, so that it becomes part of their life. You learn a language only when you use it, when it becomes part of you. For example, for my A-levels, I got an A for French. I cannot for my life speak a word in French now, nor write a full sentence anymore. It's gone because I never use it. English is like that for many. And because it's so important in our world right now, in especially the corporate sector of this country, please, if you're trying to help someone learn English, give them ways of getting the water to their life. If you're trying to do this in a hostel, of course, you might be laughed at because that's part of, you know, there's a little bit of traitorous feeling in learning a foreign language. And I'll get that to that in my next talk. But use these methods of making English relevant and part of their lives, so that it'll make it easier for them to actually learn it. Thank you very much.